Hello. Welcome to the Minnesota Pubcast. I'm Molly Burke. I'm back here with my co-host Jason McGovern.
Hello.
I was gone last week. I was 90% gone.
You made an appearance.
I mean, a short and ill-fated appearance.
Do they not have cell phone towers in Arizona? Is that one of the problems? I mean, the weather obviously isn't the problem, so maybe that would be.
There's a shit ton of mountains and Adobe.
Yeah, no, I mean,
thinking it's the Adobe, or you know, the like the barrier that the rich people put over the country clubs,
to keep the riffraff out.
Yeah, so nothing can infiltrate it. Like the tennis court was very protected.
Or cell phone waves. Yeah, that was a problem. I didn't even think that. I mean, I was smart enough to get Suhan on a landline because I knew he was at the XL, and you never know how a cell phone's going to work in a building like that. But I'm figuring you're outside at. I think you were at a tennis court is where you told me you would be when I would be calling you.
Yes.
So I'm thinking, well, she'll be fine. That'll be no problem. And you dropped out like three different times.
Yeah, I did.
But hey, you know, you made an appearance. That was fun. Thanks for coming on. I had this not really planned out, but I mean, this was kind of what I was going through last week. This was the feeling that I had. It was this. It was very sad. I'm sitting at O'Gara's and this is what's going through my head.
People were probably like, who's the weird dude with the headphones? They probably thought you were a very serious producer that likes to drink.
Yeah, I'm just practicing my craft at the bar, just pouring down
just
beers.
Spinning.
Jesus.
Spinning records.
Working on the ones and twos. No, it's funny because I've had, you know, waitresses before walk up to me because you usually get there pretty much right before showtime and I get there early and set up and they're like, oh, are you doing a show by yourself tonight? And I'm always like, no, why would I do the show by myself? Haven't you not seen me with a co-host every fucking week? Like, yeah, no. And then no one asked me last week. Sure enough. Here I am sitting here by myself talking to myself with the headphone, you know, the sports caster, you know, microphone one. That's what I was using too. So I got to ask the servers there next week, actually, or this week, and go, did you think I was just talking to myself? Or what did you guys even think I had going on there? It was weird. It was weird to sit in a bar and talk to, two people on the phone when no one knows what's going on.
And you have a setup. So you don't look that weird. It's not like you have an invisible Bluetooth.
where you walk by the person and it looks like they're just talking to themselves. Right. Yeah, no.
You know
At
what
least I
did?
Had headphones on.
Right, exactly. You know what I did a few weeks ago? I never wear my headphones when I grocery shop. You know how some people, that's like their thing. They kind of go in the zone. So I went to the furniture store and I just wanted to browse around for a while. And I was like, perfect time to call my grandma. Perfect time. Right? So I had my headphones in with my little mic and I'm talking to her and people were so confused. They were coming. They're like, do you need help with something? And I was like, did that weird thing where you like motion to the small mic that's hanging off of your headphones, and you're like, no, I'm fine.
But I thought that was a universal thing. Now everyone knew if you have headphones in and you're talking to yourself, it's because you're on the phone.
Yeah, and
especially if you have the Apple iPhone.
The Apple iPhone thing.
Those are the most obvious thing. And there is the mic that's right down by where you are. That's obvious. I think that's weird. I think the Bluetooth thing, I mean, I have multiple times walked up to people at a table, you know, when you're serving them and it's in the other ear and you don't even see them and they're talking to themselves. Right. You're like, oh my God, this person's insane. And then you just realize they're on their phone. But no, when you have the headphones in, that's
crazy.
Obvious. That's completely obvious.
That's
I don't
a
understand
fun
how they missed that.
Bus game to play. Bluetooth or crazy. Just stare at them.
What's
for
the
a
percentage?
While.
Mostly crazy, I would assume.
Depends on what route you're on.
Yeah, I suppose. It depends what area you're going to.
My route
coming
has
from.
No riffraff. The number 4 from uptown to downtown is very little riffraff.
So there's a lot of phone and less crazy, or a lot of Bluetooth, less
people
crazy.
People are pretty respectful too. Not a lot of phone talking, because that bothers me as well. I don't like when people are doing their own like public speaking on a bus. on a public bus. Like, no.
Where they're like yelling at you, basically, it sounds like, because they're so close and so loud. You mean, or?
They're having a conversation. They're having a private conversation in public.
Yeah. No, I don't understand that either. I think that something about those people, they want to be special or think they're special. They want people to know they're on the phone and they're having a conversation.
I left the office, but I still have some work to do.
Right. Like, look at me. I'm so powerful and I'm exactly needed. I'm so important.
Yeah, man. We're gonna need 8 more shipments of those.
Jesus. I don't understand that at all. But I don't understand.
Call
I don't even
back
do.
In 20 minutes.
Yeah. Well, and just who wants to listen to your bullshit? That's what I've never understood why you can't use a cell phone on an airplane, in that they say like it could mess with the their electronics. That's bullshit.
No.
They just don't want you on them, which is totally cool.
I'm totally fine with that. Except I think there is a part of airplanes that are so loud you really can't hear much around you, but you can hear the people behind you.
Yeah. Well, yeah, you can hear the people next to you, and yeah.
That's true.
I think that it would be extremely annoying, and I'm the one with the most plugged ears ever, and you know that sound. Like, I can't hear anything on an airplane because I'm half deaf to begin with. But I still don't want to listen to you on your cell phone next to me.
Sorry,
that sounds
Oliver.
Horrible.
He was like,
"Did you just smack
noise?
Him?" Oh,
no, I go.
His ears perk right up when he did.
I know he's a little weird.
You like that sound?
It.
A little weirdo. That's what
weirdo?
Gets your attention.
Huh? Yeah, for sure.
Oh.
Oh,
what?
Okay.
Oh, you got something
sorry.
To say?
Sit down.
He's going at the mic a little. Anyway, well, we finished up the show last week, and we were talking about when you dropped out for the third time, and I gave up.
I kept talking for a little bit.
I bet you
did. I was on a roll about race relations, man.
Oh, I'm sure
like,
you were.
Hello?
And then you're like, oh,
hello.
How much did you miss? Shit, how long have I been talking to myself? Well, and it all started with this stupid idea of a Starbucks campaign to have baristas writing, was it Race Together? I keep forgetting what the actual little term that they were writing on the cups, or they'd put a little sticker
on
there.
Speaking of drinking, what are you drinking tonight?
Oh, yeah, I'm drinking a Third Street, what is it, the Lost Trout Brown? Yep, Lost Trout Brown from Third Street.
I'm thirsty.
Another local brewery.
I'm thirsty.
You're thirsty, and you have
something. I
should have
gotten something before we started.
Should have grabbed a sixer.
Shit.
Should have grabbed a sixer on the way down. So I don't understand why you want to make your the person that's making your coffee and trying to. I think in most ways, and most times when I go to get coffee at a Starbucks or a Caribou or something, they're kind of just there to go, "Hi, how you doing? Have a great day." Like, just kind of a smile and move you on your way.
Sure.
I don't want them, nor would I want to be them in this situation where they're supposed to spark a conversation about anything controversial, especially when you're in a position where you're looking for tips. Like, think of the position you're putting that person in.
So what was the whole concept of it?
Just to get people talking about race, because race matters and all this stuff with Ferguson and everything.
I don't need to fucking talk about Ferguson with my barista.
No.
Make me my chai latte and shut the fuck up.
Thank you. And I'm the guy who I am all about coffee shops and bars being places where we talk about social issues and discourse, and we talk politics and all that. I think that is where it should be. That is the public forum. But not the guy who's selling you the product. Don't put him in that position. That's
no,
so awkward.
Dude, the poor 17-year-old that's working his 5 a.m. shift. None of them are usually 17. They're normally like 24-year-olds. But still, they don't want to talk about that.
No.
Don't force them to talk about it.
And even if they want to, they shouldn't be doing it on that clock.
They
like,
shouldn't.
That's not the time to be working on that.
And Starbucks has many other ways that they can become involved in social discourse.
Well, and I think this was a good way of getting involved in it. I mean, you made the news, and we're talking about it. And so the Starbucks name right now is involved with race. Like, at least you've put the two together. But I think you did it more of in a blunder way than you did to help anything. And I don't, I just.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And I just don't understand what do you expect from, like, that's like saying, hey, you know, bartenders now, from now on, just, why don't you just start bringing up, you know, white black relations or white brown relations? Like, why don't you just throw that out there and say, discuss amongst yourselves? Like, that just sounds like a really bad idea in most places. You know what I mean?
Here's your venti latte. Do you want to talk about Selma?
Right. Right. That's what I think my little line was. I'll take a medium latte and a brief lesson on Malcolm X. Like, I don't understand what they were going for. And, but it does, I guess What I took from it, though, is it does just show where we are, that this is a big enough deal to where everybody's going, holy shit, race matters, race matters. And that, I think, is a good thing. I think that, as we've talked about many times on this show, we like to think, and I think a lot of people do think, we're post-racism, especially having a black president. But anybody who does any kind of analytical thinking and looks at what we're really dealing with knows that's not the case right now.
Right.
And I think that it's cool that Starbucks was trying to say, you know, like, we want to get involved in this, but what a stupid way to do it.
Stupid way to do it. Exactly. I appreciate that they care. I appreciate that they want to further the conversation. Just not through your baristas, man. Just not through.
Too
anyway,
often.
We know. Well, we know where we're standing in this.
And the other related issue that you saw the column today, and of, you know, my former coworker and a guy I produced his show plenty of times, and always enjoyed reading his column and listening to his show back in the day when I was in my 1500 days.
Controversial figure.
Yeah,
sometimes.
Yeah. Joe Souchere has, he's considered more or less a righty and at least conservative. I thought that was actually interesting that you found a Joe column and you were all about it. But it's really hard to argue with what he said.
I grew up, like, exactly. His argument is pure logic. And I know Joe and I know his family. And so yeah. I really like him as a person as well. And I respect his strong stance on things.
And what you just said, his logic, and his show is all, it's called Garage Logic. And right. I like I said, he's coming from the right. Most people would say he's a conservative, but he's not conservative about everything.
No.
He's just more or less, he uses garage logic. Just think about it and apply logic to it. And the situation right now at the U, which, and I think I've heard about him talking about this before it ever happened, but years and years ago, or at least maybe joking about how this could happen. That's actually probably where this came from. But you've got the U of M now with a guideline to basically, in order to stop racial profiling or curb it or something, they have basically said that when they release information about a suspect that's committed a crime on the campus, that they will not release his race, his or her race, unless it is so pertinent and there's enough of a rest of the description that the race matters. To which I just want to know, was the guy black or white? Like, just or brown or yellow I don't care, or red or right. But that matters. Like, just because if I'm a police officer and I see a white guy and I know that the perpetrator was black, I can already just go, nope, not that guy. Like, I can automatically discount him, and you can reverse that too and go. And actually, in this case that he's talking about, a recent rape case on the campus, the guy was white. And the funniest part about it is, of course, the U doesn't even go with their own guideline and releases his race. Even though that's all about you really know. You know he's about 5'10 to 6 feet and what he was wearing, and he was white. That's all you know. But that's really what you usually know in a crime case like this, right?
Sure. Unless a suspect is able to have some defining feature, can sit down with those guys who do the sketches,
yeah,
and they release a sketch. You know, face tattoo. Okay, great. You know, some other defining feature. Usually there's not, though. And in traumatic cases like that, the person isn't going to be focusing on what is on this person's fucking face.
No.
But they are going
away
to see their race. They are going to see the person's race, or at least the color of their skin, whether they're, you know, whether they're darker skinned or lighter skinned, or, you know. And that's a very important descriptor, and I don't know why we became so sensitive when it comes to criminals about this.
Well, it's crazy.
I
think I can actually kind of understand where it's coming from the racial profiling standpoint. If
sure.
I were a black person, and especially a 19-year-old black kid on campus, the second you say a black person committed the crime, I guarantee you more black guys are getting messed with by security or campus police than if you say there's a white guy on campus that's the criminal. And by that I mean, I do think,
well, because that, there's less of them, because,
well, it makes
the
it
minority,
easier,
right?
Yes, it's very much easier to pick on the 5% or the 3% or whatever the population of the U is black than it would be to go at the other, you know, 85-90% that are white. But my point is
50% white, 40% Asian.
Well, good point.
A lot of international students.
I'm basing it on Minnesota population.
I know what I mean.
But I think that I get where they're saying, well, they're just going to come and fuck with all black people if you say that a black person committed any crime, and they won't do that towards whites. Yeah, I get that. That still doesn't change the fact of whether or not the person who did it was black or white, and I care about getting the person who did it. Now, is it bullshit and should we do something about harassment of innocent people and make sure that, you know, the police aren't just going after somebody purely by race? Yes. But is the answer this policy? Fuck no. This policy is ridiculous. And though you proved it by the first time they had an option of not releasing the race by releasing the race, they proved that their own policy is ridiculous.
It is. It's insane. It's totally insane. And I'm looking at this from a perspective of when I was on campus at Iowa and there were instances of there was someone who was going around the town sexually assaulting different people. He was doing the same thing over and over again. There was a time where there was a gunman, things like that. And they always released the race. Did that, as a citizen, make me automatically wary of every single person of that race? No, absolutely not, because that's an illogical thing, because chances are you probably aren't going to run into that person. It's more about how someone's acting. It's more, you know,
and that's why it's more about being aware.
To me, that doesn't trigger a fear of everyone else that could look the same way.
And that's why I think that their argument, and we should maybe get somebody on to talk about this. You know, now that we have the phone capabilities, we can wait for 5 minutes, but I think that it's more, they're not worried about the general public's perception. They're worried about law enforcement's perception, because it's like it gives law enforcement a green light to go after so-and-so, whatever, race or whatever. I think that would be their argument. I don't think that they're really worried that if you hear that a black or a white or whatever guy rapes somebody or does something on campus, that you're all of a sudden going to go, all white people are bad or all black people are bad. I don't think that we're worried about that. But I think that when it comes to the law enforcement security side, they kind of do, because they do
police
profile. I mean, and I completely am pro-profiling as a law enforcement person or a military person. I want you to profile, because I don't want you to shoot the 11-year-old kid. But if he's a 30-year-old male, that I want you to look at those two people very differently. You know what I mean? So that is profiling. And then you can take in race and all that stuff. But I'm just saying, in general, you're going to profile. You're going to profile male versus woman. There's all kinds of ways to profile, and not necessarily in a negative way. But I think that it could possibly be looked at as negatively if the police are doing it and they're doing it with a broad brush. And I think that's where all this is coming from, is that they probably were. Or at some point, people have seen, I mean, look around the country, look at Ferguson, look at all of this. We have seen a lot of broad brushes. And I think that that's what they were afraid of here. But it's so nice, actually, to see that the U itself even realized, no, we're not going to go with this. Didn't work.
And I think that the most important thing that needs to come out of this is, for future instances, release every single detail you can about the person, right? Race, weight, height, defining characteristics, clothes, whatever it may be. But if there isn't a lot of information, if it's just race and if it's just what they were wearing, like this person, it was night and obviously it was a very traumatic experience, she didn't remember much, then they need to be clear that they really are not sure who this person is and what this person looks like. And I think that by putting that blanket statement out there, it keeps people from maybe becoming fearful or police of targeting certain individuals. I would hope. I mean, I think that there needs to be as much released as possible, but also if there really isn't a lot of information, it more needs to be like, hey, this person was wandering around this park at this time of night. This is how he was acting. You know, it's more of a behavioral thing rather than a physical appearance, because I think that's how criminals are going to usually act the same way over and over again.
Yeah, well, and I think that, let's go the opposite direction of what you just said. If you're going to follow this policy down the road it's going down, you're going to have, well, you can't say he was fat. You can't say he or she was fat.
Well, you can say he was now, 6 feet and 300 pounds.
But my point being, if it's something that people look at where you can pick on a group, now, all the police on campus are going to go over after all the fat people.
I mean,
that's unfair.
But is more, like the term fat is more of a, I would say, an objective opinion. Do you know what I mean?
Being black or white is completely objective too. That's my point.
No, because you're not going to look at a white person and say they're black. You could
no
I could
objective
look at,
meaning you either are black or white.
Oh no, unobjective. I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, or subjective is what you're saying.
Subjective.
No, but what I'm saying is no, it is objective.
Unobjective.
Slide past that. I tried to help you.
I love when I do that. It's like a dictionary on air. Molly's learning time.
But no, okay.
You know what? I type words all day, okay? Sometimes I just don't want to think anymore. Yeah, sometimes I do like to make them up.
I don't even remember where I was going to go with that now.
If that's a subjective opinion, I think
black or white. You think is
no,
no, yeah.
Someone being
someone
you can't say oh they were ugly and they were fat. It has to be like race.
Okay, let me try to word it differently then. Okay, let's say like you were saying, he was so and so height and he was 350 pounds.
Sure.
Well,
approximately.
But now aren't they gonna just harass all the 350 pounders? That's not fair. We need more information.
No.
But I'm just saying, isn't that the argument? Isn't that the not releasing the race argument?
No, I don't know.
I'm saying because they're saying if we say they're black, they're gonna start harassing all the black people.
No.
So when does that become tall, short, fat, thin?
Well, they already do that, is what I'm saying. They already release the height and the weight.
But that's what I'm saying is when does this policy go farther and they start saying, well, not only can you not release the race, but you can't even release the weight because that's discriminatory.
Well,
it's just this policy is so asinine. Sure. I just don't know where it ends.
I get it. I get how you don't know where it ends, but I think race right now is a hot button issue. I don't think calling a criminal a fat guy is a hot button issue.
Right. That's my whole point. It's just, and I hate making slippery slope arguments, but that's just, you don't even need the slope. We've already talked about, you already fell off a cliff.
We're already
like
off
this
the cliff.
Is, yeah. But if you wanted to pretend that this wasn't a cliff and it was just gradual, this is how it would go down. Like it would just keep going worse and worse. To the point where you would just, there's no point in even releasing information about a suspect about anything because what you're not giving the people that are looking for him any fucking information or the public themselves.
Sure.
Hold on. Was there another little race tidbit? Because, God, we do a lot of race.
No, I don't think so.
Which is cool. But no, we don't. Maybe Martians.
Which is
maybe
cool.
Martians are cool. We can talk about that.
Two white kids.
Yeah, just break down race for y'all, you know. Straight from the Midwest, because we know all about race here. On that note, why don't we take a break? We'll be right back here on the old Minnesota Pubcast.
Legendary Minneapolis-St. Paul sports radio personality Jeff Dubé's energetic sports talk jumps right into the nitty-gritty local sports details you're looking for. No one else is delivering you sports news, current events, and guests with Dubé's gusto. Join him live at any of his bar perches or live streaming Monday through Wednesday only on the Alive and Social Network. Just go to JeffDubéShow.com. The term foodie can sometimes come across as a tickle pretentious. BT and Lydia are here to demystify the term and reclaim it for the sake of good food. Their weekly podcast brings in fellow foodies and culture creators from the Twin Cities to talk about all things food. Find this duo only on the Alive and Social Network.
You know it is, though, right?
I'm going to Outside Lands in San Francisco, and they're playing there.
Where? You said you are going to that?
I'm going to Outside Lands.
When is that?
That's in August.
In August, okay. So I will probably see them twice before you do. Because I will see them.
Okay.
Well, no, I'm just saying, I'm going to see them here at First Ave on the 27th.
We're talking about Tame Impala.
Tame Impala, for those of you who haven't figured that out yet.
We're acting like fucking douchebags.
I know, a little bit.
Oh,
well,
you don't know
we're
the
just
band,
assuming.
We
yeah, if you don't know, go fuck yourselves. But no, I'm going to see them in May, and then I think I'll see them at Bonnaroo as well. I believe they're playing Bonnaroo this year, so that'll be cool.
Probably.
And I know they're at Lollapalooza. I might just go to Lollapalooza instead of Bonnaroo.
Sold out.
You can always get in there somehow.
You can maybe get in there somehow.
But it's a lot cheaper to go to Bonnaroo for me because I can work there. But if my cousin goes to Lollapalooza, I'll work for him there. That would be awesome.
That would be
fun.
Do
it all for free. So that would be sweet.
Yeah, that would be cool. Paul is playing at Lolla.
Yeah, I saw that.
Yep.
Who are the other big ones? Do you remember?
Metallica. Paul McCartney and Metallica.
I read
headlining.
Okay, really weird tangent here. I read the weirdest little story about Lars from Metallica. on one of their biggest albums. Don't remember which one, not the Black album. I definitely know that one. But so probably the one before that. But it was the weirdest thing. So it's the story about the producer talking about that album. And they're kind of asking him, like, why is there no bass guitar on that album? And he goes, because Lars, the drummer, made me take it out. Like, they would go and they were in Lars. Okay, Lars had a different producer that he had this perfect setup where he literally took a picture of the board and said, this is how I want my levels. Like, so he'd bring it to this other producer and go, you're going to do it this way. And he'd do it, but then he, I don't know, it's a little above my pay grade. I don't know much about how do you make music, but he would go in and then they'd be like, oh yeah, that sounds good, but keep bringing that bass down. And then, no, that's close. Now bring it down like three more decibels to where you basically couldn't hear it. Like Lars, the bass drummer, or the drummer, got rid of the bass guitar on that album. And I do not understand why, but the producer is so pissed off to this day.
Do
and
you
this
want
is
me to,
15 years later.
Do you want me to text my friend Eric right now? He is the biggest Metallica fan.
See if he just...
In the
if
whole...
He, if it, if
world.
He ask him, hey, do you remember the album that doesn't have any bass guitar on it? If
hey,
he knows what it is,
do you remember
he'll
the Metallica album that? Okay, it doesn't. Oops,
that doesn't have enough bass or much bass guitar. Yeah.
I'm gonna go to Outside Lands. Done Lala, super fun. It sold out really fast, and I was like, you know what? It's the week before the week. You know what? I can't go to Lollapalooza. First mention of it on the show, Nersh Fest.
Oh, is that the same
August
weekend?
First. So I won't tell. Oh.
Is that a response from
Eric? Said Saint Anger.
No, that's not the album.
Maybe.
No, it's older than that. It's one
older
of their like
that.
Two or three big ones. God, I should have printed that article.
So we're going to have couple of my buddies on to discuss Nersh Fest 2015. I won't.
When
get
are we
too
doing that? Do we not
right
know
now.
Yet?
Pretty soon here.
Okay.
And it's a super exciting event. Won't tell you anything. You can Google Nersh Fest if you want. And it's going to be August 1st at Harriet Brewing. And it's a really fun concept.
So. No, and this is, it's never too early. I mean, August is, it seems like it's far away.
It comes
it's
up fast.
Tomorrow. It's
especially,
tomorrow.
Especially with all of the different events that we have going on around here. Every single weekend there's a block party or a concert or something. So
well, and literally,
put on your
I
calendars.
Mean, that's like 6 months away. I've been working for Alive and Social now for 5 months. It's unbelievable.
You mean
that's,
we've been working for Alive and
well,
Social?
Well, but I started with Dubé before you. I mean, you and I met like the fourth Dubé show I had done. Or I mean, I've been doing Dubé for a little while.
So 5 months.
So you're after me. Your seniority is less than mine. No, but Jefferson said today, like, you know, we've been doing this for 5 months. So and so, I'm like, oh my God, like, does not feel like we've been doing this for 5 months. Feels like it's been a couple months, but not five.
Yeah, not five.
Not five.
I still have no idea who you are. Who are you?
It's gonna take you a while to get to know.
There's a lot of complicated layers to Jason McGovern.
There's a lot. I'm an onion. Real quick, we talked about it at least on two different shows, I think, the Mars thing, and I don't know how you call it. It's a not a competition, but like a drawing, or you enter in to be one of the people who goes to Mars, one of the 24 people that goes and colonizes Mars, and you never come back, and you die there. Did you read the other story that I found about this last week?
Yeah, I read it today. Because, wait, can I have a sip of your beer? I'm really thirsty.
You parched?
Super parched. Oh, it, over that board.
It didn't sound... you'd be surprised how many times I've delivered beer right over this board.
That's pretty good.
It is good beer. When we read about this the first time around, and then it kicked your ass, okay. Or what?
So Eric says Metallica didn't like the new bass player.
That would have been the reason?
Booze fueled. That's what he said.
So it was just a personal, like, vendetta type thing.
I guess.
It was like, fuck you, new
personal
guy.
Personal vendetta. Yeah, that sounds right.
Anyway, all right, so the Mars thing. So what I find interesting is you would think that somebody who's going to start a mission to Mars, that is the cutest fucking thing ever, that we're looking at Molly's dog right now, shaking his head and doing whatever the hell he's doing over there. You would think that if you're going to start a project where you're taking people to Mars, that you would already have an idea of how you're funding it. You know,
I think they did have an idea, well, and it dropped out.
Right, the TV. Now,
the reality
this
show.
Would be a now this would be a reality show that I think would work worldwide. Would it not? How does this show not work? I would watch it.
I would watch it.
Yeah, and we've seen the people that would sign up for this. They're fucking crazy. So
right.
It'd be interesting to watch. Like if you like reality TV, this is great reality.
Someone
TV.
Someone could like die at any moment, like for real, die and. No one, you don't want to miss that.
No. This is crazy must-see TV right here.
This isn't fake Armageddon. This is real.
Yeah. So okay. So this the story that I found last week is an interview with a guy who is one of the people that is still in the running, one of the last 100 finalists that's still in it, and he said that basically he thinks this entire thing is a fraud, and the way that you earn your points within the system of the Mars colony system, whatever, is you buy their shit or you donate money to them.
Right.
So you want to go to Mars, all you got to do is just raise the most money for this program, basically, is the way they've turned it. Where the whole thing was supposed to be, they thought they could make, I think it was 60, was it 60 billion?
6 billion.
Was it, okay, that's still a large number. It's they thought they could make $6 billion off the reality TV show, or off a
it,
TV
it had
show
like a $4.5 billion possible, you know, yeah. Worldwide market.
And I totally buy that. I think that's realistic. I don't think that's crazy. But it's now that's apparently fallen apart. And it's not even just that. It's because I even saw the look in your face maybe that you're like, well, no shit, they'd have to sell stuff. Like, they don't have any money now. But to me, it's what this guy was also saying is they're not even like really vetting people.
No, they're not vetting
They're not
people.
Even really, they know your name basically. And then they don't care after that as long as you send them stuff and send them money. Like,
right.
Which, god damn, like, this was a bad idea for the actual people that would go anyway, right? I mean, we already kind of talked about that, like, who would really want to do this? But if it's a scam in the first place and you're really investing yourself in this, like, that would suck. Like, you really thought you may be going to Mars and you were really trying to be one of these last 24.
Is it a scam if they actually pull it off?
No, if they go, it's not.
They send people who raise the most money? I mean, does that make it a scam?
Oh,
you know what I mean?
I guess
not. That they sent the people that maybe shouldn't have gone, that weren't the most qualified to go or weren't the most mentally prepared to go, but because they raised the most money or earned the most points or however they're kind of doing this bullshit system, is that still a scam?
I think that if you were going to do this in a way where anybody could join in anyway, I don't think, maybe you're right. Maybe there's no problem with it being just monetary, but to me, this should be scientists. These should be qualified people. These should be people that, I think we kind of talked about this too, that are shown to be sane. I mean, you have to go on a spaceship for...
Do we care if they're sane at this point, though?
Well, no, I mean for the safety of the other crew.
Sure.
I mean, not for our entertainment value. No, I don't want them to be... I want them to be fucking balls of the wall nuts. But for the people on the spaceship to get to Mars, because we do want them to get there, don't we? Like, wouldn't
sure,
that kind of make
like
it cooler?
Them to get there.
I think it'd be more interesting. Now, it'll still be interesting if they don't, but it would be a more interesting story if they make it. Like, if they actually try to colonize Mars, that would be interesting.
Yes.
I don't think Joe Blow is going to be able to make it. I don't think I can make it. I don't think I've got the... I mean, I don't know how much training these people are supposed to go through and whatnot anyway, but I mean, they're talking about doing this within 10 years, so I don't know. I mean, your typical astronaut, I would like to know how much training, how many years, how many just, I don't know. I think that you should be qualified in more ways than just, yeah, I threw in a bunch of cash or even just,
sure.
I made a Kickstarter account that somehow raised the most. Like,
well,
that should not be what gets you in.
To note, this guy that they've interviewed or that's making all these statements now, he's like an astrophysicist.
No, he's a scientist.
He's
yes.
like an astrophysicist or something.
He's like an astrophysicist.
He like studies space.
Like totally, like he knows that shit.
Well, I mean, so at least they're picking people that are scientists.
Well,
or
but he's
interested
he's,
in science.
He is, but are they all? He made it sound like
know.
They're not necessarily.
Is it kind of like, this is a really stupid statement, but is it kind of like flying a plane? I mean, I know astronauts are smart people. They're not dumb. Right? They're brave. They're smart. But do you have to be like brilliant at math? Do you have to be brilliant at technology? Or is it something where you can really take the time? If you're a semi-intelligent, above average intelligent person, can you learn to fly it? I mean, it's the people within NASA and it's the people within, you know, that are kind of doing the back end stuff that are really making it all work.
Yeah. Well, I think that.
But, you know, you still have to be brilliant, I think. I mean, look at what those guys on Apollo did. They figured their.
Well, no, and that's actually where I was.
Tom Hanks figured it out. He's super smart.
Yeah, they had the sock and the tube and the. But no, I think wasn't that when they didn't they use a sock? Did they actually use a sock? I think they did.
Yeah. I love that movie.
Oh, it's so well done. But no, but I think okay. I like what you're thinking because no, if it's 1968 and you're trying to fly the moon. You need geniuses on that fucking... You need to be on that spaceship. Sure. You know, you can't just have them on the ground in Houston. You need them on board. But I think maybe today, with the technology we have today... I mean, you know, if you've heard this one, your cell phone has more technology than the first piloted manned spacecraft. I mean, it has literally has more, like, memory and computer storage and all that than
that
did.
Yeah, isn't that crazy?
So, with the technology, I think you're right. I think you can basically put on autopilot. Literally, you don't have to land it. You don't. But here, even this... Let's say the landing auto land whatever the hell fuck I don't know auto land doesn't work.
Let's just preface: we have no idea what we're talking about.
Add that to the that should be actually at the beginning of the show. We should that should be in the intro.
We are not.
We're telling expert. Terry Daniel.
And the one we're changing thing, it. The one thing that I am supposed to be the expert on, I couldn't even get right today.
Yeah, language. Yeah, you're the writer. Fuck, we're so fucked. But no, really, seriously, Terry Daniel has to change up our little intro, and it's not the I don't what is it now? It's the candy is dandy, but liquor is quicker.
Whatever.
Which does that applies? That does actually work for us. But it needs to be just like warning, warning. These guys know nothing about what they're talking about at all. but no, but okay. So what was it? My land, the auto land. So auto land goes down, and now you're literally, you know, going through a planet's atmosphere, and you're flying at it at thousands of miles an hour, and you can't just know. You don't figure that out on a whim. You don't just kind of go, hey, I'll just grab this joystick and maybe figure it out.
But here's the point. Space travel is still dangerous. Super fucking dangerous. No matter how far we've come in technological advancements, it's still dangerous. So when you get to a point like that, anyone is fucked. No matter if you're a genius or not, I feel like if something goes wrong, you're done for.
I feel like maybe not. Buzz Aldrin fixes it. Buzz Aldrin says, I'll auto-land this bitch myself. Like, I'll land it. You know, one small step. No, I don't know. But I don't. No, I know. But I think that I want to see the smartest and the brightest go. That's I guess, what I'm going at. I don't want to see just the schmucks that have money.
Do you want to see, like, the middle smart people so that if they don't make it, we don't feel that bad about them dying because we didn't lose, like, five highly intelligent individuals?
Well, I don't want Stephen Hawking on the deal, all right? No, let's keep
the best and
brightest. You know what?
Stephen's getting a little pessimistic lately. I feel like he should maybe go. He's getting a little, like, everything that comes out, he terrifies us with more terrifying news about
how... Are you talking about, like, the black holes the Hadron Collider and all that's going to fuck us over? And
he keeps coming up with these crazy things, and then you trust him because he's Stephen Hawking.
Of course.
He's brilliant. But he's like, these doomsday scenarios back-to-back all the time. And I'm like, Stephen, man, you can't freak us out like that. You can't freak us out like that, Stephen.
You gotta lay off, Stephen. Seriously.
Relax.
We're already worried enough about life.
We are.
Another tangent. Did you see that they really think they are close to contacting a parallel universe with the Hadron Collider?
That's cool.
Isn't that fucking crazy? Just to even think that that's a possibility. That's always been like science fiction crazy. Like, parallel universes or multi-universes or an unlimited universe. We don't even understand the universe we're in, and we're going to start delving into other universes.
That's cool.
That's crazy shit.
That's cool.
Very interesting.
And X-Files is coming back, too.
Is that real?
It's real.
Okay. So I've never watched an episode, like, so now I got to go watch them, for sure.
Yeah, go watch them. It's like a short 6-episode or 8-episode, kind of special mini season series. Really?
But it is going to be them, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Wow. That'll be kind of cool. I do need to... I can't believe I never got into that series. It's so up my alley. I'm such a sci-fi dork.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's good. I also am not like... I don't like binge watch it or anything, but I've seen enough where I thought it was interesting.
Let's take our last break, and let's totally switch gears. Can we talk about that Duck Dynasty fuckface? I mean, guy, do you want to talk about that?
Sure.
This is.
I don't need. Yeah, let's talk about.
We'll just
him,
talk about it,
and then we can talk about something fun like TV. Yeah, he's on TV.
Well, yeah, but not that. Well, that we would ever watch. But yeah, we'll come back. We'll do that, and then we'll talk some fun TV stuff, and we'll wrap her up for this Wednesday's edition of the Minnesota Pubcast.
Join longtime radio personality and producer Kelly Guest and friend, CEO of Fantasy Gifts, Colleen Bertino, as they talk about all things sex, men, women. Lend them your ears and learn everything you wanted to know about sex and intimacy. Only here on the Alive and Social Network.
Reach for this one.
Just when you thought it was safe to go back online.
Just turn it on. Kind of,
that took a very PG direction.
Along comes this hit show.
I'm constantly burping on stage.
Hey, you heard about Madonna, right?
Twin Cities hit show with Rusty, Courtney, and Chuck.
Had she fallen to the ground and her eyes rolled into the back of her head, what would you, Tim Mahoney, have done?
I'd have tried to make out with her.
Nice. Get in line.
The Twin Cities hit show with Rusty, Courtney, and Chuck airs live daily, 9:30 to 10:30 on the Alive and Social Network.
Ever swallowed a bug or choke like Courtney on stage?
Yeah.
I meant to do this.
We're back, the Minnesota Pubcast.
I love Tame Impala, but they really do sound like the Beatles sometimes.
See, I always compare it to Pink Floyd, but yeah, you're right. There is a little Beatle thing there.
It's like the later Beatles when, you know, they went all Hare Krishna on us.
Does he make the albums by himself and then tour with a band? Have you ever heard that?
I don't think so.
Okay. I've heard that he... Maybe. Because it is pretty electronic. I think you could pretty much do that. I heard that he mixes it all himself, plays every instrument himself, does it in the studio, and then when he goes on tour, he has a band. But well, I'll find out for myself, I guess. I think that's kind of a cool thing, but also kind of lame. Like, because I love thinking of like the chemistry of the Beatles, all playing together in a studio
really
and all that.
They have a good jam band feel. I would hope that doesn't... that's not the case.
I don't know. I've seen a video... and it was him, and he had he was featuring someone else. Like, it wasn't even someone else from the band, and it was an entire song.
I don't know. They're pretty like, I should probably Google when they're this on shit. The stage, they're pretty bandy.
I've seen them at festivals and stuff. It seems like you would think what I just said would be complete bullshit,
right.
But that's where, when I saw this, just a recording of a music video, it looked like, oh no, maybe he could just do all this by himself and he just brings in people to like sing on it or something, but he even sings most of it. So I don't know. Like I said, maybe I should probably Google this shit before I bring it up. What do we want to talk about? Do you want to do Duck Dynasty or should we go music?
I don't know. That guy is just so
annoying.
He's
just such a douchebag. Here's what I found interesting. If you haven't heard yet, is it Robertson? Is that his name?
Robertson.
The old guy from Duck Dynasty. For those of you who don't know, you're lucky. But he came out today and he made this awful. Maybe it was yesterday or the day before, but he came out and made this awful way of saying that atheists just don't believe in right and wrong. They don't. How could they possibly know right and wrong? They don't think there is a right and wrong. And the way he said it was so disgusting.
Yeah.
About like having a guy watch his family get raped and murdered in front of him, and how the
graphic
killer could just go, well, there's nothing. There's no right and wrong. So why would I? And it this idea that only religious people have morals, only people who have read the Bible have morals. Like that is such. And I commented on a Facebook post about it today of a buddy of mine, and I liked it. I know he's a really devout Christian, and he asked me. He said, "Seriously though, where would you get morals if it weren't taught to you, like you know, by the book or something, or by religion?" And I said, "Well, I believe that 99% of all people have right and wrong built into them.
Absolutely,
and it's because evolution-wise, we as people will survive longer." Procreate, create more, last longer, grow as a population if we treat each other with at least some dignity and respect as we wanted to be treated. You know, it's the golden rule didn't have to be told. The golden rule was happening way before Jesus. You know, the golden rule existed ever since a neighbor said, hey, you put up that fence, I won't cross it, you don't cross mine, I won't fuck with your cattle, you don't fuck with my cattle. Like, this is not, you don't need to be told this by some holy man. You just don't need it.
Well, exactly. I mean, and that is why, that's why there's people that are inherently evil, because something has gone wrong with them, biologically speaking, that makes them not have morals. And thankfully, that's a very small amount of individuals. And then, not to mention, there are plenty of very bad people out there who are very Christian and very, you know, Muslim and all sorts of different religions, and they're bad and they don't have any morals. So it's really dependent on biology, and thankfully most of the time that biology works.
No, it
and you can blame it on whatever you want. You can blame being a good person just because that's what you do, or you can blame it on spirituality and universal. That's kind of my thing. Like, universe is kind of run by love, so that's why we're good individuals. Some people blame it on Jesus. That's what you do. You follow in Jesus' path. Whatever you want to call it, no matter what, like you just said, biologically speaking, humans are meant to be good.
Yeah.
And we know that inherently.
And it's funny because I did basically just say that, but I never looked at it the way you just said it, where biologically so is evil. Like, that's yeah. also biological. And that I've always thought as evil is spiritual, but good was biological. Isn't that weird? Because I figure you almost have to like step out of a normal human being's experience to be evil. So that seemed artificial to me. But you're right. It's just as biological, because like I said in my own argument, I think 1% of the population is just fucked. Like whether it meant like your brain chemistry or whatever, which would be a physical, biological thing. You just like, you know, you're schizophrenic or worse. You know, there's just people that you're a child abuser or whatever. That's I believe you don't fix that. There is no cure for that.
Sure.
So that would make it biological. But so can we flip that argument though? Because this is maybe the scary part, and maybe this is where people like the Robertsons would come down and maybe have a point, scarily, isn't that an excuse then? Where do we own up to our own actions? Because I do think that I control it to a certain point, but then at a certain point I don't.
Sure, sure. You know? Well, I think it's not black and white, right? As humans, we know what we're supposed to do, unless you are the 1% people that they really... You really don't know, and you are
guided by some sort
of dark. It sounds really weird, but you're guided by some sort of dark force, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, these inherently fucked up people, like, you know, the kid that did the Newton shooting. Nothing is fixing that guy,
right? Jeffrey Dahmer, the psychos.
But the normal people. Oh, my sister's calling me. Sorry, Lindsay.
Doesn't she know we're fucking doing a podcast?
She does listen a lot. Sorry, Lindsay, I had to hang up.
She's
on
obviously
you.
Not listening live tonight. I'm
She's
pissed.
Not. I mean, but I don't think it's black and white. We know what we're supposed to do as humans. But everyone, there's always that little push and pull, right? There's so many different dynamics to us.
And that's what I'm asking, is that physical or is that whatever else is the mental, the spiritual, you know what I mean?
Well,
how much of this is spiritual?
Our whole dynamic of how we make choices and whether they're good choices or bad choices, to me, that's biological. It's how you keep yourself from making the bad choices is where this kind of comes in. To me, you could say, I don't make bad choices, or I try not to make bad choices because God guides me to something higher, something better. Some people would say, I try not to make bad choices because that is part of being a human and helping the world. So there's, I think, different reasons for why you know, you keep yourself from doing things.
But and I, just to be clear too, hopefully my buddy that I talked to today about this is listening too, but I'm a believer. Like, I do believe there's a higher power. I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's Yahweh or who it is, but I do believe that something created the universe. And like you said, I believe it, that the language of the universe is love. And that, so that, that was created by something somewhere. But I've met plenty of atheists. I listen to Carolla. I've talked about it plenty of times. And Bill Maher is an atheist. And I think Bill Maher and Adam Carolla have morals. Do I necessarily agree with all their morals? No. But do they have morals? Yes. Do they have a moral compass? Yes. Do they need to read a holy book to get it? No. Like I said, I do think that's built in. But there is a level to where the built-in part reaches another part where, you know, like society as a whole or other people.
Absolutely.
Like, this all clashes at some point.
I mean, part of the human experience is avoiding doing bad things, quote unquote bad things.
Well, yeah, well, it's inherent evil, right. Inherent vice, as the movie I haven't seen yet. But we do. I think we all are susceptible. I mean, I think I've heard, you know, holy people say that all people are capable of the worst evil in the world.
Absolutely.
But so there's the line. There is something there where we have some kind of control over it. But this bullshit that you have to have read a holy book or need a person of the cloth or something to explain morals to you, otherwise you don't have them and you don't know right and wrong, just flies in the face. Like, monkeys know right from wrong.
Honestly, know right from, exactly.
They do. They have to, especially any animal that cooperates as a society. I mean, dolphins know right from wrong. Like, we don't even have a monopoly on that.
True. We do not have a monopoly on that.
No, much less just religious people.
As live beings, we know right from wrong. And I don't know what, I don't know where that even comes from. People come up with these crazy ass theories and it's like, how did you even come up with that, man? I read that thing and I'm like, what? I think it's just fear.
Well, it's fear.
I think that's all it
and
is.
It's I think there's some power in you don't know right unless you know my guy.
Right.
And my guy knows it and only he knows it. And that's what's even, I mean, I've read that that when Jesus said, "I am the Son of God," That's not even the fucking literal interpretation from the Hebrew. It's actually, "I am Son of God." That's a very different statement. That's a fucking completely different statement. Because I am Son of God. I mean, you're a daughter of God, right?
Yeah.
But would you say you're the daughter of God? Isn't that fucking presumptuous? and so even if, like, and that's the stuff that baffles me and it makes all religion interesting to me is that it is interpretation. It's written by men. But if that was the case, if he just said, "I am Son of God,"
where did you hear
that? That changes the whole thing. I don't even remember. I don't know. I read so much about this kind of shit.
I love these conversations. I just wish I had never took one religious studies class, and it was fascinating. I had an amazing professor who was also a rabbi, and we did a Judeo-Christian and Islam tradition. And it was really fascinating, but there's so much complexity to it that I can't even comment. You know what I mean? I'm like, if people believe that and it doesn't impede on me and it makes them a better person, I'm totally okay with it.
And that's why you're here, and that's why I like talking to you. But you're so not the norm. The norm thinks they can simplify this and they can put it into very basic things like, well, if you're an atheist, you don't know right and wrong. Like, people think you can actually make little boxes like that.
Right.
And you are smarter than that. You know there is no box. I think so. You're trying to think outside the box. speaking of which, let's get out of that box. Let's talk about this music You bring it up. I think it was a great City Pages article or a great City Pages column.
Yeah. It was like there's nothing wrong. There's nothing wrong with their music. There's something wrong with you, I think was kind of the title of it or something.
No, there's nothing wrong with new music. There's something wrong with you. Yeah.
Nothing wrong with new music. There's something wrong with you.
And it's a great title because that does apply to every generation.
That's
every
true.
Generation has done this.
Sure.
They go, well, my shit's good and your shit sucks.
But sure. No. It's fine. The whole premise was we kind of go to the next generation. And when we kind of move out of that generation of what's popular at the moment, you automatically think it's bad. So you hear a lot of older generation now saying, looking at our music, and they're saying, "Fucking sucks. What is this shit? Our music was so much better, blah, 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 blah." Or, you know, people our age or, you know, in their 30s saying, "Nirvana was the best, and how can you listen to this fucking One Direction shit?" You know what I mean? So no matter where you are, you always think that the newest music sucks. Do we agree with that? Does music really suck right now, or are we just not into it?
Well, I know where I come down on that because I used to be okay. I grew up listening to hip hop, and hip hop to me did pretty much die in about 2000, maybe 2002.
Who did it die with?
Kanye's first album. I mean, honestly, that was like the last good hip hop album that I would really, truly, honestly say people should really listen to.
You didn't like any of his. any of his past, his most recent albums?
I listened to College Dropout. I've never listened to any of them ever since then fully through.
I've heard singles off of Kanye.
I know, but I'm just, but my point being, and this is the whole point, is when I was growing up, I was under the impression that everything that I listened to when I was 16 through 19, which is what almost every person does, was the best. Now, with hip-hop, I think there's even somewhat of a case to be made. I really did live through the heyday of hip-hop. I mean,
you did.
The mid, like, early 90s through 2000, was, I mean, there was
like
never
West
better
Coast,
hip-hop.
East Coast shit.
Oh, my God. You got Tupac, you got Biggie, you got Wu-Tang, you've got Talib Kweli and Mos Def and all that stuff. You've got De La Soul and The Roots. I mean, there's so much. But then, to me, because I got older, I think that's the only reason. I think that's what this column is kind of pointing out. I went, well, you know, Ludacris and Kanye and Lil Wayne and all that kind of stuff. Oh, they suck. That's bullshit. That's not good compared to what I liked.
Like me, I like a lollipop. That's my Lil Wayne impression. Did you like it?
It was not good. No.
What? You didn't like it?
It wasn't too bad.
I thought it was kind of close.
Well, I actually have a friend that can rap just like Lil Wayne.
She's really?
22-year-old girl. And she can she can rap Lil Wayne straight up. But
I'm just going to keep throwing my bad impressions, and every once in a while, that's okay with
no,
you.
No, go
I'm
for practicing. It. Go for it. Got any Wu-Tang? Can you do like a
no,
Raekwon or something?
No.
But so I was under the impression that it just, it after my time, it sucked. Because kind of like we're saying, where it's just because of my age, I was, you know, I turned 22 and basically went, well, that's the end of music for me. Like, there's no more new music to be heard. And then, like, actually, my last girlfriend and my buddy Tim at Moe's are the two that have introduced me to new music, not hip hop, but new music that is fantastic, like Tame Impala, which is kind of why I've been playing that all night, because I'm going to see them. But like Tame Impala, Arctic Monkeys,
you do talk about them a lot.
I am a little obsessed with Tame Impala. But I mean, there's, you know, you've got like Beach House and
Beach House,
Grizzly Bear, and I don't
Beach
know,
House.
Well, even like I was never into the Flaming Lips, who have been around for a long time. But like, yeah. I just didn't realize that people were still making good music. I still, to this day, will say, I'd like to see what you think of this. I think the greatest album recorded during my lifetime, and this, I mean, there's probably a lot of case to be made against this one, but is Nirvana Unplugged. Okay. I really do think that from track 1 to 10, I think it's only like 10 tracks, that to me is the greatest album recorded during my lifetime. But that doesn't mean that there's not still great, even like there's not grunge rock anymore, but there's still that alternative grungy rock is still going, and it's still working. And did you saw holy shit, what's the movie? The basically about the end of rock and roll. Oh, Jesus Christ. I can't even think of it right now.
No, I don't think
I had it in my head a second ago.
I don't think I
saw it. You've for sure seen it.
I've seen it?
Yes. Holy shit.
Almost Famous. I own it.
Yes, thank you.
And I've seen Almost Famous.
And to me, Almost Famous was
classic rock and roll is what you're talking about.
Yeah, and it's about the death of classic rock, basically.
Yeah.
And or glam rock, or well, not even glam rock, but and that's, to me, that's what happened between like 99 and 2002. That was the end of hip hop. Like, it was, I felt like that movie described that perfectly. Like, it was the same slow death that it was going through. But I think that what this column is saying and what we're saying, I think, is that it's just purely our personal preference and age, and we just get stuck in a thinking of this is the best. But there's always good music being made. But there's also a lot of bullshit music being made at all times.
Sure, sure. And I think that maybe the difference now, and you can stop me if you think I'm wrong, but I think back before the internet and before there was a lot of technology, it was really going into a studio and making a record. You know, you'd go in, you'd have your guitar, you'd have the mic.
You had
piano,
instruments.
Whatever,
you just nailed
instruments,
it right there.
You had
that,
instruments,
yeah.
Exactly. And people still do play with instruments. But
no, yeah, but less.
You would go in, you would make a record, and the radio stations would really play a lot of the same stuff. And there were very talented artists out there, obviously. But I don't think there was a variety that there is now. And you know, and then you kind of hit the rock and roll era where there was, you know, people started hating rock and roll because it was loud. And then you hit the hip-hop era, and now we're hitting this kind of, like, technology area.
Dubstep and whatnot.
Sure, but even beyond that, there are a lot of indie bands and experimental bands that are not dubstep, that are not electronica, that are using computers. And so you're getting this huge variety of not only people still really playing real instruments and going back to kind of folky roots.
Yeah.
And people using their computers to synthesize everything, And you have so many different things to listen to, so many different things that you didn't have before. And you can make the argument, sure, like pop stations, KWB, they still play that poppy stuff that's been around for 20 years, whatever. That's maybe the bullshit that this person's talking about. But I think that that argument really can't be made anymore because there's so much more out there.
No, that, and it's actually, if you think there's no good music left,
You're not researching, you're not enough, looking, man. At all.
Just what you said is so true. It's the everyone has access to making music now. You don't even really have to have musical talent. Now, that would help, obviously, and the best are hopefully going to. But you can make music these days without the ability to play a guitar, without the ability to play an instrument.
Yeah.
And so if you can do that, think of all the people that also can play instruments and do all that stuff, too, that are really creative. It's really, right now, it's just almost, it's too much out there to grasp it all.
So overwhelming, and I have Spotify Premium. I don't know if you have that.
I don't have Premium, but I do listen to Spotify.
I don't know if you guys have any good suggestions out there, listeners, for what you use to kind of discover new music, but I found Spotify to be a super helpful tool for me to discover new bands. I also use SoundCloud to discover like really local people doing weird shit on their computers.
Pitchfork is a really good website.
And Pitchfork. But that's kind of how I just click on a few songs on Spotify and they recommend, you know, it kind of builds over time out of my playlist and what I listen to. And I've found some fucking insane people through Spotify.
You can even just go to an artist you already like and it'll throw up six or whatever. Absolutely. That are related that you might have never heard of.
Some of them I hate, and there's some really good shit out there. Yeah. So,
all right, guys. Well, we are tomorrow. We're live at O'Gara's, 5 o'clock, as usual. So come on down. We'll buy you a beer. This applies to the first three this time.
Oh, the first three. I like that.
So if you actually listen to the show before tomorrow and you make it down there by 5 and you're one of the first three, I promise you, I will buy you a beer. Till then, we'll see you next time.